How are you guys doing? I'm excited to be here. First time in the Philippines. I was told first that I would have 45 minutes to present, but then they explained to me that 45 minutes Philippines time means that I could go over to an hour or something. So I would take the most out of that. You know, it was a long trip from Miami, had a stop in San Francisco, a stop in Hong Kong, but it was for a good cause. It was the second year in a row that the FRAs invited me to come. Last year we could not make it happen because agendas are crazy. This year I'm here. And I prepared something special for you guys. Hope you enjoy. It's a real pleasure to be here. Thanks again for the invitation to come. Let me see my deck. What is it? Can you switch? Yep. It's not projecting. I think you have to switch to my laptop. That's the beauty of being the first person to present, right? That you want to get all the tech stuff out of the way. But we actually rehearse in the morning, so it's going to be fine. So this is me. I'm usually wearing that. I never, hardly ever wear a jacket. I just wear a jacket because I was coming to the Philippines and I wanted to look good in the pictures. I've heard that you guys love selfies and stuff. Like yesterday in the restaurants, like everyone counts. 1, 2, 3, and takes a picture, like some all professional, all high angle. It's amazing. Like in Miami, it's really shitty pictures people take when you ask. Like here's like they all look perfect. Like I'll do my new LinkedIn profile picture, just ask any of you guys to take the pictures, going to look good. So I'm actually usually wearing that, which is the Burger King crew member shirt. And I've been with Burger King for 5 years now. Before Burger King, I did my whole career in Unilever. I know that Unilever is very strong also in the Philippines, it's strong in all Southeast Asia. So very proud of the work I did there. I still have like really good friends in Unilever. I was there for a very long time. I think that after 18 years working in Unilever, when your friends start to nickname you Unilever, it starts to feel a bit odd. So I thought it was time to change. And as I said, like very, very proud of the work we did there. My last job at Unilever, I was the global VP for brand development for Dove, working out of London. We did this, which I think like most people that work in marketing or advertising have seen that. And I remember like leaving town and leaving that year, which was 2013, which was an amazing year in my career, thinking like, oh, I will never be able to top that. You know what I mean? Like, this is by far the best work I will ever do in my whole life. It was like one of those accidents in life where everything that can go right goes right, which hardly ever happens. You know, most of the time, you have a great team, you have a great brand, you're working hard, but shit happens always, right? So that year, like, nothing bad happened. It was amazing. And for the first time, I was not itching to do the next thing in my career, and that's why I decided to leave. And then to leave Unilever, which was my home, and go somewhere else, it had to be a place that would be significantly different than what I had in Unilever, which was consumer goods. So I basically called Burger King. I called them, they never called me. I knew some guys there, like there were a bunch of Brazilians back then from 3G. So I called them because I grew up, and by the way, I'm Brazilian, that's why I have this funny accent. If you're trying to pinpoint where I come from. But like, I grew up in Brazil looking up to the amazing work that Burger King did when I was a kid. I was a weirdo because I always liked advertising from the very early stages of my career. So we used to gather around some friends' homes to watch the reel from Cannes or the One Show. There was no internet back then. Like, you could not just download the thing. We were waiting for the VHS or the Betamax. Like, if you're laughing, you're 10 your age. So, like, but like, we get the Betamax with the ads, and we would sit and grab some beers to watch the stuff and see like what's up. Like, this is super old. All that cool stuff. So I grew up like one of my favorite campaigns of my whole life still is Whopper Freakout, which is the second image on the top line, the second from left to right. I still remember Whopper Sacrifice with a titanium in Cannes. Or when Burger King sold a game for Xbox, I think it was 2006, And that was the number one game for Xbox in the United States that year, in terms of units sold. So can you believe that? A fast food brand had the number one game, like a unit sold. So the brand was clearly on fire, and the agency that was behind most of this work was Crispin Porter Bogoski, which was literally like on fire with Mini, with Truth Campaign, with Burger King, and all that stuff. And I always thought, like, one day, I want you to be part of that team. I want you to be able to do that type of work. And that's why I called Burger King, because I was crazy enough to believe that I could come and help the guys do stuff that would be maybe not as good as that, but at least closer to that. And this is me on my first week working in a restaurant. We used to have that shitty uniform. Now it's a nicer one that I show. You look like a mechanic when you're wearing that uniform. And I'm usually not that fast, it's accelerated, you probably can tell. Like, I really screw up speed of service, and like, they hate when I come to work in the restaurant. So this is like this footage of me working is like from 5 years ago. But the reality is that like when we started doing the work, and back then there was no global marketing team, there was not really like much of a marketing team at Burger King, the reality that we found was very different than the golden age from Crispin Porter. Yeah? So for instance, what we had on TV, this is like one TV spot that I will show that was on air 5 years ago back in the US.
Exciting things are happening at Burger King.
Welcome to Burger King, honey.
Your crispy chicken strips.
So I said, Kung Pao. The Kung Pao is all the meal. Have you tried the sauce yet? Who's that talking?
Steven. Need a hairnet, Tyler.
You need to get some hair, John.
Exciting things are happening at Burger King.
Hey. The new crispy chicken strips. Come and get it at Burger King.
So I need to be honest with you. Like, I hate this with passion. You know, like, I watch this campaign, and I always present this spot on my presentations. It makes me want to throw up in my mouth. Like, I hate it. Because it has nothing to do with Burger King. You know, like when you, like after my presentation, maybe not after my presentation because I have a great presentation coming up just after my presentation, but like when you get home today, go on YouTube and search for Whopper Freakout, which in my view is the best campaign of all time from Burger King. Like you watch Whopper Freakout, and it's like raw, real. You watch it and you believe what you're seeing is honest and real. And that's what this brand is about. By the way, most of the most effective communication that I did in my career, it was always very believable and very honest and real. Like, I remember when I did Real Beauty Sketches, people would come to me and say, oh my God, it looks so real. How did you guys do that? And I would look to the person and say, well, it was real. Like, we didn't know if it would work. Like, we just shot the thing. And if it didn't work, we would trash it. And it's all good, because as you guys know, produce something exactly cheap, the expensive part is to media money. And we'll talk about that later on. So we are willing to take those risks and produce stuff even when we don't know. By the way, when we don't know, we actually like it better. I'll also talk about that later on in my presentation. But the point here is, how did we go from this, which is Whopper Freakout, and you can see how real it is, right? To this, you know, like a David Beckham buying a strawberry smoothie with a glow of light coming from his back, and he's wearing a suit. You know when that's going to happen? Fucking never. Nobody that curse a lot. But that's a reality, it will never happen. And your consumer is a little bit smarter than what you think. You know, and people don't buy that bullshit anymore. Like, your board on your company will probably like it because they know who David Beckham is, because they think Steve Tyler is cool, and it's not. Because they think that Jay Leno is awesome, that was another celebrity on the campaign, or that Mary J. Blige will connect with the African American, and it was a disaster. Like, I attended a billion focus groups for Burger King in the US. No one ever mentioned this campaign. It didn't drive sales. It didn't drive any brand attribute. It's completely empty. You know, like, it didn't exist. And it was damn expensive to do. But the board of my company was probably like, oh, that's great, David Beckham, Jay Leno. They probably got home and told the wife, oh, Jay Leno, David Beckham. No one gives a shit about any of that, especially if you produce like that. I mean, if David Beckham had a real lean connection with the brand and you shoot it for real, something that's believable, I would buy it. So my point is not don't use celebrities, but use people who are credible to your brand, who have a history for your brand, that helps build the brand. By the way, I bet if I ask you what was the product that was advertised on the spot that I just presented, you don't remember. Because even the product choice to advertise sucks. You know, Burger King is not a place for chicken strips. Like, that's generic. Like, I'm the underdog. I need to sell chicken fries, Whopper. We are not a place for strawberry smoothie. We are a place for Fruit Loop shake. You know what I mean? Like, it needs to have an edge, even on the products that we sell, else it doesn't work. And again, it was not just about advertising. This was the packaging design that we had back then, 5 years ago. It's almost as someone did a research and discovered that talking about freshness is important in fast food, and then they do a bleached white packaging that looks like hospital food, and they put in bold capitalized font that the food is fresh, when no one reads anything. Like, I don't know what's the variant of the shampoo I use, and I look at that thing every day. I know it's Head and Shoulders, and the thing is blue and white, but I have no idea, and I look at that thing every day. But I never read that. No one reads this. I presented this deck a trillion times. I don't remember what is written on the package. I have to look at, oh, fresh preparations, like this is king, oh great. You know, like, no one cares. I would rather the design work the other way around. I would rather the design semiotically communicated that had craftsmanship, that is fresh, and had nothing written on it, because no one reads anything. It's like when I go to the Apple store. I look at the stuff sometimes, and I feel like, oh my God, this is so cool, I want to buy it. What is it? Like, I don't even know. Like, when I bought my iPad, I didn't even know how the hell I would use that thing. You know what I mean? Like, but it drives desire. You love the design. Like, there's nothing written on that stuff. It's just design. So this is not good. It's very generic. These were the merchandise. Merchandising is the posters that we put in the restaurant. In many cases, merchandise is really important because not all countries where we are present, they have money to advertise on TV. So a lot of the advertising that we do is posters in the restaurant. Yeah? Look at this. I mean, it's super ultra generic. It could be for any brand. You know, the King Sundays, the blue one could be McDonald's, could be anything. You know, like, I'm not even arguing, like, the design, because who wants to eat a sandwich sitting on a pillow? Right? I mean, or like a chicken sandwich with a pink background that makes the food. Now we can see you guys. No, we cannot. Like that light here. But like the pink background makes the food look sweet and cold. You know, so there are some basic rules of design that this doesn't respect on top of being super generic. And again, I know this is a mix of advertising and marketing crowd. So I'm kind of like, I have information to please both. Because I believe that creativity drives business, so it will show both sides of the equation, right? This is the evolution of Cannes Lions, which you probably cannot read, but Burger King is a brand that won the first Lion in 1969, and it was much harder to win Lions back then. You know, like when we won the Titanium Grand Prix with King's Games in 2006, and that was one Lion. If it were today, it would be 23, yeah, but there it was one, and the agency guys know what I'm talking about. And then on the 4 years before we started doing the work, we basically won two bronzes and we had zero in 2 years. It's very new for a brand like Burger King. And by the way, the two bronzes were probably campaigns that we didn't even approve, because if we had to approve, we would kill them. And so it's really, really weak performance for the brand. Machado didn't lose for Mati. This is a corner in LA. Yeah? So it's a super competitive market. And I'm not plotting the mom and pop, the hot dog stand, the taco truck. I'm only plotting kind of like the key main competitors. I'm not plotting Starbucks. And in LA, if I plot Starbucks, this thing would be green. You know, like, in LA, there is a Starbucks in the bathroom of the Starbucks. You know, like, it's like a plane, you know, like everywhere. So it's like a super competitive market, which by the way, I think that I'm sure that I can do this chart for all your brands. Because there is no market, I never seen a market where the marketeer raised their hand and said, no, my market is super easy. It's not competitive at all. Like, all markets are super competitive, yeah? And if you're like me, meaning And back then, this graph is outdated, and you cannot read, but this is media spend in the US. And back in 2013, we were the number six in terms of spending in media. Today, I think we're number four, so it got a little bit better, probably because other people invest less now, because we kind of like invest the same. So if you see a graph like this, there are two types of marketeers, and I've been both. Like in the beginning of my career, I was always complaining that I needed more money. Do you know how many times I got more money? Never. Yeah. And working for 3G Capital, if I say the word money, they cut my budget. So I don't even like bring that up. You know. So the other way, which is what I became, is when I see a graph like this, whatever you do needs to stand out. You know, standing out is my dollar multiplier. If I play by the rules of the game, if I play by the rules of other people, I don't stand out. If I do the same, the category cliches, what everyone else is doing, which makes you feel very comfortable, I'll give you that, but I'm not going to stand out. And if I don't stand out, the one that wins is the guy that's on the top. If I do things that are generic, if I advertise chicken strips with Steve Dyer, and no one associates my brand to that, I'm doing a service to the category. And when you do a service to the category, not to your brand, the brand that benefits the most is the brand that's top of mind, which in this case is the brand that invests the most. And in your country, I bet it's the same. So if you do generic stuff, your main competitor, the market leader, will like it. That's why many times the market leader tends to do more generic stuff, because they are more afraid of losing than eager to win. They have more to lose. So if you're the underdog like me, I have very little to lose. And whatever I do needs to stand out, it needs to be quintessentially Burger King. Quintessentially is always a big word for me. I'm always afraid when I have to say that. It needs to be quintessentially Burger King, which doesn't mean slapping a big logo on the stuff. It means that I need to build a brand in a way that when people look at the stuff, they think, oh, only Burger King could have done that. That's how success looks like. Doing things that people talk about, share, and that get earned media, because that becomes my dollar multiplier on the media plan, and doing things that people look and say, oh, only Burger King could have done that. So we always use those filters when you're judging work. And it's funny because in Miami, in our office, in our previous office, we just changed offices, we're still like redecorating, but on the previous office on the first floor, we had like a museum with the brand, and there was a statue of the king. And I remember that 4 or 5 years ago, we used to make the joke with the agency that if you got really, really close to the king, you could hear the king whispering, what the fuck are you guys doing? Because this brand is amazing, amazing. And you're doing like Steven Tyler bullshit, like generic advertising, and doing packaging that looks like hospital food, and doing merchandising that could be for any brand, and spending the money exactly the same way as our main competitors spend the money. Like, how the hell do you think you're going to win on that case? So something had to change. So what I'm here to present to you, that was my intro. So now the people who told me that I had an hour, but it was Filipino time, I started to get concerned with the time. No, but that'll be fine. So my presentation is basically like the main five things we did that helped us change the game in terms of the trajectory that the brand was taking. We were losing share. We were not making money. We were losing share. The brand was not growing. I will show you the numbers. Don't worry about that. And the first thing is pretty obvious. The first thing is you need to understand your brand. You know, I cannot brief for packaging design, advertising. I cannot try to make things differently if I don't know what the brand is about. You know what I mean? Like, how am I going to do great design if I cannot explain to the agency what the brand is about? And one of the biggest mistakes that I've seen lots of marketing people do is when they say like, oh, we need to do a new positioning for our brand. Then they lock themselves in a meeting room with the planner, with a flip chart, and then they start to brainstorm about what the brand should be, like how we're going to reinvent the brand. That's all good, but honestly, in cases of brands that have a history, that tends to not work so well. Like for us, the starting point was different. for us, I mean, since Burger King is a brand that has been in the marketplace since 1954, we started by asking ourselves, why are there people out there who still love this brand, despite the fact that the work that they're doing is pretty shitty? Because there were people who loved the brand. It was funny, like, when I came to Miami to do my interview at Burger King, when I was leaving, the guy who was responsible for North America, Alex Macedo, which was the guy who I called when I wanted to move to Burger King, he told me, hey, wear this Burger King shirt as you go back to London, and then you see how people react to you, yeah? It is amazing, like, every time I wear Burger King stuff, people who I never met in my life, they come and talk to me as if they knew me. You know, in the airport, it happens all the time. I wear a lot of Burger King, and every time I go through customs, I get like, do you have Whoppers on your luggage? And I have to laugh because I'm trying to get through customs. But like, people always, like on Uber, Uber drivers always say something, oh, do you guys have a kitchen here? It's a Burger King, like, do you get free sandwich? Like, there are places that have this power, you know, that they unlock something that creates this connection. With Dove, it was very similar. I remember I was based in London, I used to travel a lot to New York, working for Unilever, and I would arrive on customs in New York, which is pretty tough customs, and I would give my Brazilian passport, which doesn't help, and then they would say, like, where do you work? And then if I said, oh, I work for Unilever, people would always say, like, what is that? And I would say, well, it's like Procter, but does other stuff. And it's like, okay. Or, which I've learned, when I said, oh, I work for Dove, they would be like, oh, Dove, like, our real beauty, this soap, my wife loves Dove, like, it's such a great brand, you guys do an awesome work. Like, it creates a connection, you know, and Burger King is the same. You know, like, it's unlikely that many other fast food brands have that same type of connection. So we wanted to understand why was that, so that like, we can kind of like feed that love in a consistent way, you know, like create a process to pay back the love that these people are giving to us, because we are not doing that with the work we're doing. So the first thing we did was go to the streets and ask people, like, hey, I will tell you a brand, tell me the first thing that comes to mind. So you say Burger King, the first thing that people say is Whopper. And then you ask, like, what about the Whopper? And then people say, oh, it's flame grilled, it's a messy burger, you eat stuff drips on you, it feels very fresh, it doesn't feel it came from an assembly line, which tends to be the perception on fast food in general. It feels a little bit more natural. Burger King is not first date material because it's really messy, la la la. They talk about this perfectly imperfect sandwich, yeah? Like, it's very consistent across many different markets. And then the second thing we look is like, who are our fans? How do they look like? How do they behave? And look, fast food is a fun occasion. So you can go to any social media feed and look at fast food fans from any brand, and you're going to see lots of people having fun. But if you look at Burger King, what you will very quickly realize that for some reason, our fans are a little bit more out there than the average fast food fan. I mean, sometimes it's the same person, because the same people go to Burger King, McDonald's, Wendy's, but when they are at Burger King, they behave a little bit more extrovert, okay? And we ask ourselves, why was that? Like, why is that? Why they behave that way? Which probably helps explain the way people talk to me when I'm wearing Burger King stuff. And then we thought that maybe there are two main reasons for that. One reason is that for many years, we told people to have it their way, right? I mean, that was the slogan of the brand for so many years. And many people take have it your way as respect for their individuality. So they are not shy about showing who they are in their individuality. And the other reason is the crown. Like the crown, the paper crown, is not a thing for kids, okay? You go to a Burger King in the US, which is half of our business, you're going to see lots of adults wearing the crown. Most of the time, adults are wearing the crown, it's not for kids. And the crown has this amazing transformative effect on people. This is a guy who we are interviewing in Miami, Yeah, and he's answering all the questions seriously. And then someone comes and puts the crown on his head, and you can see like how the attitude of the person changes. It's almost like it brings out your 12-year-old version of yourself. And sometimes I present this to finance people, so I have a diagram to illustrate the transformation. And there are very few brands that have that, that have an asset like that. You know, no one can copy that asset. You know, it's unequivocally Burger King. So the combination of perfectly perfect food with perfectly perfect people felt to us as a very fertile territory to explore. And always play around the crown, the idea of perfectly perfect, and the idea of respecting individuality your way. And the tone of voice of the brand, which is the other part that I'm not talking as much on this deck, is also very, very important. You know, like when people see stuff from Burger King, they expect it to be funny. You know what I mean? They expect it to be a little bit prankster, a little bit out there, a little bit crazy, almost illegal, some of the stuff we do. Like lots of people, when they see the stuff, they think like, how did they get away with doing that? You know, it's all legal, by the way. I'm still free. I never went to jail. But that's kind of like the tone that you're trying to achieve, so that when people look at the stuff, they think only Burger King would have done that. This is an example of a campaign. I only put new stuff. I'm not showing burning stores. I will talk about Google Home a little bit, but I'm not showing old stuff. Everything that I'm showing to you is either fresh new stuff done probably like in the past 6 months. This we did in December of last year. Didn't go to Cannes. It did go to the one show, it did go to Andy, but it's going to Khan and D&G now. So just play the video and then we can talk a little bit about it.
Burger King wants you to come here. Yes to McDonald's.
Burger King is trolling its fast food rival
with a promotion available through the Burger King mobile app.
Yeah, but there is a small catch.
So I thought it's Burger King commercial where you can get a Whopper for a penny.
Only if you open the app while you're at McDonald's.
That doesn't even make sense. You have to go to McDonald's for a Whopper?
Whopper?
Use Burger King's BK app.
Then be within 600 feet of a McDonald's restaurant.
Burger King has geofenced over 14,000.
14,000 McDonald's restaurants in the U.S.
Unbelievable. So I park my news car about 100 feet from a McDonald's.
I feel weird. I'm at McDonald's getting a coupon for Burger King. I almost feel like I'm stealing.
Go for the unlock.
You unlocked the Whopper detour.
This is a really cool promo, guys. How fun is this?
Understand. Like we didn't do for any of those reasons. Like we did because we were launching mobile ordering payment as a latecomer in the market. You know, like the coffee shop next to where I live, which has one restaurant in the whole planet, has mobile ordering payment. Like everyone has mobile ordering payment. If I just go and launch mobile ordering payment, no one cares about that. It's a big deal for us because it was really difficult to do the POS integration and all that good stuff, but no one gives a shit about that. It's important internally, not to the real people out there. And by the way, we did test Oh, let's give away products. If you order through our mobile app, you get a free Whopper. No one does it. Because if you think about it, it's like a Whopper is like $3-$4. You change your routine, drive to a place to save $3-$4, and you still buy a Coke and fries. So in the end, you don't do it. Like, all brands did that, like McDonald's did it, Chick-fil-A, Burger King, Wendy's, they all did free stuff through mobile. And it doesn't take off. What made this success was the idea. It was a big idea that made people care. Why? Because it's fun. It makes absolutely no fucking sense. If you go to someone and say like, hey, I'm going to do a campaign. There are two campaigns. One that's like this. You download the app, you got a free water. Okay? And the other one is like this. You download the app, you have to drive to the competitor, order from there, and then drive back to Burger King to pick it up. And you need to put your credit card data because it will charge you 1 cent on your credit card. Would you do it? Oh no, let's just do the free stuff, it's easy. No, because I know my target. I know that they will go crazy about an idea like that. That they will tell all their friends, that they will take selfies, that they will film themselves doing the stuff, and that's what happened. You know, like, we had to put zero media money behind the scene. It was just the idea, and then it takes off, and then it becomes my dollar multiplier. And by the way, now we have like 10 million people in our mobile web in the US. 1.5 was just in 10 days that we acquired with this campaign. I have their location, and it took us a year, but we geofenced at 14,000 McDonald's in the US. So I know when these people are going to McDonald's, and I serve them a push notification with an offer. I know where they live, I know where they work, it's not illegal. They accepted to provide us the location. You have to provide the location if you're doing mobile ordering, because the price varies a little bit from restaurant to restaurant. So just to be able to give you the menu with the right pricing, I need to know where you are and in which restaurant you're going to. You know? But then we have all the CRM structure on the backdrop that now help us capitalize the data that we have. But it's all on because we went all in with a creative idea. Had we played it safe, it would have been yet another campaign that you never heard about, just like the ones that we did before this one, to bring people to the mobile app. The first point is understand your brand. The second point is create a great brief. And honestly, like, I've been in marketing for more than 20 years, more than 20, I'm just thinking it's more than 30 or not. And I did write my fair share of carrier briefs. You know, in the beginning of my career, I thought that if I wrote a 10-page brief with answering every single question people may come up with, I have done my job really well, you know? And when in reality, it's just the opposite. You know, the best briefs are super sharp. You know, they focus in one thing. You know, every time someone on my team brings a brief, it is like, I ask like, what is the insight? And what's the main point that you want to communicate? And then the person says, oh, the main point is we want to communicate this, this, and that. I'm like, no. It's main points. It's singular. You know, like, if you are asking to communicate three things, you haven't done your homework as a marketeer to figure out what is the one most important thing. Because the more stuff you pack inside that campaign, the less people take out. It's not me saying that. You can ask Neil Brown what they think, and they'll tell you that, if that's what you believe in. Like, the more stuff you put in, the more you dilute the main point of your link test, if that's the methodology you use. Ask Ipsos if it's not Neil Brown. Like, it's out there, the information's out there for you. But you feel safe. Now, let me over all my stuff. Like, let me put all these 10 things and ask the agents and force them to. And it doesn't work. Now, I love this quote. I didn't have time to write a short letter, so I wrote a long one instead. And every time I get a very long brief with lots of things in, I say that to my team, and I ask them to review the brief. This is the type of briefs that work well for us. And by the way, these are ongoing briefs. Burger King Flame Grills, right? So I always have to communicate that. So the brief, Because Fire is Better, is there for anyone to bring ideas. It's not a competition. I will do all the great ideas that people bring to the table because I always have to communicate that. Showcase Whopper Love. I know that every time I show how people are crazy about the Whopper, I sell more everything. Whopper freak out is exactly that. It shows how people are crazy about the Whopper. And then the other one is more of like an emotional belief as an example, which is encouraging people to be their way, which means let's showcase that we welcome everyone, that we respect individuality because we put the crown on everyone's head, because we encourage people to have it their way. So these are the type, and guys, I mean, we have a one-page brief. If the planner really wants to read, like who the target audience is, what's the inside, blah, 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 we have all that. By the way, two of these briefs are public. One is on the D&D New Blood. We briefed students with this brief. By the way, last year we won 3 lines with student work, like real lines, not like baby lines, like real kind of lines, with student work that we did for real. And one of them, I think, is on the one show, Young Ones Competition. And if you Google and search, you'll find the whole brief. It's there. It's not like, what we do is not rocket science, like it's not like super ultra confidential. It's pretty obvious, like what you're trying to do for Burger King. And the briefs are simple, because I want to make sure that the creative guys always remember. The guy can be watching the last season of Game of Thrones, he remembers the brief. Like, when the brief is bad, I don't remember the brief an hour after the briefing session. And I bet it's the same with you guys. You know, like, and then the creative team will think about your brief like the day before they have to present to you, or sometimes in the car, because the traffic is so bad that they can't afford to think in the car as they're going to present to you. You know, I don't want that. I want the guys to have ideas when they're having a shower, when they're like dating with their boyfriend. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I want the guys to be thinking about the brand all the time. And we accomplish that because of two reasons. Because the briefs are really super, ultra simple and memorable, and because they know that we are the type of client that is willing to pick up a fight and do a good idea. And that's why we get disproportional amount of good ideas. And I hope that all the other clients that work in my agency are really shit, because then the great teams that work for the shitty clients will start thinking about my brand, because that's how it works. Like, people want to do good work. So if be careful if you're a shitty client, because they're probably working for Burger King. Or to the other brands, because someone in your agency probably figured out that too. You know, so try to be the client that people want to work with, you know, and brief it simple and memorable. These are some examples of stuff that came out of these simple briefs. So from Because Fire is Better, in France, we did an ugly Christmas sweater that had like a pocket, and we had a video of like a fireplace, and then you can slide your phone, and then the flame grills the Whopper on top. You know, this is super simple. Like, the cost to do this was zero. We just went to a retailer in France that's famous there in France and told them, guys, we want to do a partnership to do a limited edition sweater, and you can sell. We don't want to make any money. We just want, like, as a giveaway in the restaurants. You know, super simple idea. This one I will play. This one is from, it's a mix of Whopper Love and Flame Greening. It kind of like does both things. We did this for April Fool's last year. And I think it's a pretty cool video, so that's why we're playing for it.
Well, the Burger King, what kind of effect did it have?
The chocolate Whopper. Was that an April Fool's prank?
I think so.
Ah! Oh, yeah. That's right. We launched a new chocolate Whopper. A flame-grilled, tantalizing chocolate sensation. Our most decadent Whopper ever. Except we didn't.
What? There's no chocolate Whopper! Oh, I wanted to try it!
So sorry, Internet. People had to have it, so they made their own. And guess what? Our fake news became real news.
It's a new Whopper from Burger King. Ooh, a chocolate Whopper.
Yes, it is.
You love hilarious brand-related comedy. It's
let's
nice
hear job. It, Jason.
You're welcome.
Sometimes you don't want to be an April Fool's joke, and you actually want it to be real bad.
Don't cry. I was thinking the same thing. Spectacular. Ooh, look at those logos. impressive. Make it rain. Control the whole world, baby. The chocolate whopper. After all this, we'll definitely launch it next year. Maybe.
So it's funny because like there was a point in time over this past 5 years that we went from having to convince people that this was good for the brand to have people internally and consumers demanding that we do more stuff like that. You know what I mean? Like, and there is a tipping point there somewhere, which I cannot really pinpoint when was the year, the month, but it did happen. You know, like this is like, again, zero media, like zero. We didn't spend a cent in media. It was just like a stunt, and we got like a ton of like media value, and you can see the shift in brand attributes, you can see the shift in engagement. You know, people talk about likes and shares in social. Here, people like cooking the thing at home. You know, like what's the difference of level of engagement? We made people drive from McDonald's to order something to then come back and get it at Burger King. That's massive analog engagement. You know, it's not even digital engagement. And that's the type of thing that we're always trying to do. The third point is let the idea grow. And I think it's a really important point. Most of the ideas that were very successful, that I was lucky enough to be part of, especially at Burger King, but also on Dove, when they were presented to us, we kind of like didn't know if they would work. Sometimes we didn't even know how to do them. You know, when Whopper the Tour was presented, and the guy said, yeah, so we want to geofence all the McDonald's in the US. I'm like, whoa, there are 14,000. Like, how the hell they're going to geofence 14,000 locations? No, we don't know. Then there are two types of marketeers. There is a marketeer that kills the idea right there. And there's another one that says, like, fuck it, let's figure out. You know, like, guys, if it were easy, someone else would have done it already. So we like that we don't know. If I don't know what to do idea after more than 20 years working in marketing, that's a good thing. It probably means it's new and different. It will probably work. Like all the ideas that I see, like, yeah, like that's easy, piece of cake to do. Like they tend not to work. I used to work with a guy called Cash Sree. He was from BBH New York. He left BBH New York a long time ago. He's amazing, really cool guy. He did Night Tag, which is a good film Grand Prix income many years ago. If you know that one, it really shows your age. But he used to say that when a cunning lion is born, it's a baby lion. It's very easy to kill. And it's so true. It's very easy to kill. Like, all the ideas that are crazy, when they are born, they are very fragile. You know, you need to handle them with care and nurture them and help and trust uncertainty and feed that beast. And then it will grow. And today, everyone believes that they supported Whopper the Tour. Now it's easy with the results, you know? But in the beginning, it's like, holy shit, like, but are we going to really do that? Like, how are we going to film that? Like, how the hell did we film inside of McDonald's location? Like, we didn't. We filmed the drive-thru. By the way, there are a couple of states in the U.S. where you are allowed to do that. So, but we figured that out. We didn't know that when the campaign started. So that's a beautiful campaign, in my view. We did this around mid of last year. We did first in Spain, then we did in Korea, then we did in the US. This, I think, is a film from the US. This idea, when was first presented, everyone was like, no way. Like, people are going to make fun of us. They will say that our food is exactly like dog food. That our food is not for people, and you're mixing dog food with people's food, is not going to work. Cut to, we presented this at the Burger King convention, in all of that, in North America, in Europe, in Asia Pacific, and it was like standing ovation. People freaking love the film, and that's why it became global and was launched in so many countries. But if I explain the idea without the film, many people in Canada would have killed it. And by the way, I was not sure if it's going to work or not. We thought it would be cool, it would be great, so we decided to do it. And then after we saw the results, I go, that's great, let's use it. So let me play, that's a short one, and I think you'll like it.
Maybe I'd love you quite as often as I could have. Maybe I'd treat you quite as good as I should have. You are always on my mind.
About the importance of craft, you know? Like, the first time this idea was presented, it was like, oh, we want to do a Facebook post announcing that we're going to give this thing over a weekend. And it was just a bone that would come with the sandwich. And then we said, no, the bone needs to be a flame grill. If you want to call it dog bird, it needs to be a flame grill, just like the Whopper. Else it's like, anything can be a Whopper. No, it needs to be a flame grill. Okay, fuck it, 3 months more on the timeline so that we can find someone who does that flame grill. And then it was like, we just want to do a pitch. No, let's do a film. It works much better on a film. Like, I want to pick the director, so I chose the director in the production house. But the guys didn't have money, so I gave them some money to do. And then we shot, great director. By the way, I said, let's do a merchandising poster. Oh, we didn't have money, so I paid. I got Ali Brissett, who's an awesome photographer from Argentina, to do it. That's the next shot. And then we were discussing the music. Yeah? And then the director said, you know, I think it will work really well with Willie Nelson. I'm like, fuck me, man. Like, this would be like a fucking $1 million now. And then, like, do you want to, I put Willie Nelson on the as a track. Do you want to see it? And I'm like, oh, no, don't show me. And then he plays, and then I said, no, I cannot see the film with any other music now. You know, like, oh, but again, he poured, like, no. I want the original Willie Nelson track on the film. And, oh, it's expensive. Yeah, the track is more expensive than the whole film with the print. But if I had gone with a pared-down version of that, maybe other markets wouldn't want to use it. You know what I'm saying? So it actually is cheap, because if I do something that 10 markets use, it's cheaper than if each market does their own thing, you know. And that's exactly what happened here. This is the print, by the way. It's very dark. It's actually much more fun. But honestly, like when I presented the first time, people's reaction was the face of this dog here, the boxer. Like, oh my God, you're going to mix dog food with our food. And you can see on the film that there's really nothing like that. It's a very touching film, and people are smarter than you think, and they get it. This is a cool example. And this one is about trust, yeah? So the guys from Lola in Spain, it's our agency in Spain, they call me and they said, hey, we want you to come, we have this big restaurant in Gran Via, which is on a key street in Madrid, and it's one of our main restaurants in Spain, and we want you to turn the restaurant into a haunted house for Halloween. And I'm like, man, like, you're going to lose a lot of sales. It's so like a week with like one of your main restaurants that makes probably like 30, 40,000 euros per day. Like you're going to lose like 7 days of that. Like that's pretty expensive. No, we'll keep the kitchen open and we'll sell stuff, but we want to turn the whole restaurant into like a haunted house, and to buy, you need to go to the haunted house, and you're going to hire a guy who does stuff for Disney, amusement parks and stuff. It's going to look awesome. And I'm like, man, I'm not sure about that, because like, Halloween's not such a big thing in Spain. It's growing, but it's not like in the US or the UK. And they're like, God, man, trust me. I was like, okay, fuck it, just do it. Yeah. So this is him filming with an iPhone on a Wednesday night. It was raining. And this is the entrance of the Burger King, okay? Just so that you see the line of people. And he was very happy, right? Rubbing on my face that he was right and I was wrong. But that's the thing, there is no right or wrong. You know, like, I want the best for the brand, he wants the best for the brand, there is trust. So I did many ideas that, like, I didn't even believe on the idea, but the guys believed it so much that we did. We have, like, you know, like when you go on Disney and they take pictures of you, like, and then they sell for $45 at the end? So we have that, but we're giving away the pictures to people. And honestly, I could spend the whole afternoon just looking at the faces of the people. No, this is brand experience. You know, like, you'll probably not forget that one. Look at that. Oh my God. My favorite, this is my favorite. Like, what the fuck is happening there? Anyway, I have two more, and I will finish mildly on time. So number four is the biggest risk is not taking any risk. And that's not a phrase of mine, it's from Mark Zuckerberg, so it's probably infinite times smarter than I am, and probably a much stronger source of authority for quotes. And this chapter to me is like, there are two questions that people tend to always ask me. Yeah, one, which is, aren't you guys afraid? You do all these crazy things, aren't you afraid? And every time people ask me that question, I feel like they don't know us that well. Because it's not like we are afraid sometimes. We are afraid every fucking time. Like, I'm always afraid, you know, always afraid. Like, when I did Global the Tour, I was afraid. When we did the thing that we did during the Super Bowl with Andy Warhol, I was afraid. When we did Dogger, I was afraid. When we did, like, I was afraid all the time. In fact, if I'm not afraid, I don't do it. That's the thing. The key thing is not to be fearless. Like, that's bullshit. Like, if you're not fearless, only if you're like a multimillionaire, you're not afraid of like anything, you can just go home and drink tea. You know, I need to pay my bills, so I'm afraid all the time. But I do it because I believe that being afraid means that there is something there. And because I trust my agency partners, we're able to come together and pull stuff out of fear that works, you know? Like, I always had this joke with my previous CEO. He's now co-chairman for 3G, so he's doing pretty well. He used to stop me on the corridor and ask, Fernando, what are the three, four things that you guys are working on? And I would say, like, yeah, we're working on this, 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 and this. And he would say, oh, I love number four. We should definitely do number four. I would kill the idea immediately. Immediately. And it's not a joke. You can Google his name, Daniel Schwartz. Marketing, Burger King, he says that in many interviews. He tells that story. Because the ideas that work the best for us, they're not ideas that are easy to approve, or easy to everyone, like, galvanize. It requires you to fight. People think that Burger King is like kicking an open door, and it's not. I have to fight every time. I'm the CMO. Like, my team fights every day. Like, if you want to do great work, get ready. You have to fight. You're going to have lunch by yourself many times. Like, you need to be able to cope with fear, uncertainty, like all that shit. Because if it were easy to do great stuff, everyone would do it and everyone would be happy. And it's not like that. And then the second question I get is, but what happens when it goes wrong? Right? I mean, the first question is like, aren't you guys afraid? Which, yeah, we are. That's actually what motivates us, is one of the things. And the second is like, what happens when it goes wrong? And to explain what happens when it goes wrong, I will show with data, yeah, or kind of like helping explain with data. This curve here, it's the number of, when something happens, not on advertising, in life, the people share that in social, right? And the press covers, like in the press. The peak of shareability or coverage usually happens at 48 hours. Okay? Well, the first 24 hours, only people who are very close to the topic, they share or they talk about it, it peaks at 48 hours and then it starts to go down. So for instance, when we do a campaign, usually like I post on day one, most people will post on day two, and then my mom sends to me on WhatsApp by day eight when the church group that she has on WhatsApp, someone sent to her. Yeah? And then I know that everyone was reached. In Brazil, at least. And the thing is, today, the media cycles, they are frequent and short. You know, people, like, 2 days from now, no one will be talking about the halfway. I think people are not talking about the halfway now anymore. You know, like, people move on so fast on the conversation. You know, like, you talk about something, then the next day, something else, something else, something else. So this is like, when you pull back in time, this is from 2017, and this is the example from Google Home. Like, the month started with everyone talking about a tweet from a certain president, you know who, right? And then, you probably remember that, there was an ad from Pepsi with Kendall Jenner that went really bad in the industry. The real people didn't give a shit about any of that. But everyone who works in marketing, because, oh my God, like, look at that, terrible. Like, my mom didn't care. My mom probably enjoyed that. Church group loved that ad. You know, like, but we, on our small advertising marketing bubble, we thought that was like a disaster for the brand. And I'm sure that the guys at Pepsi, and I know some friends, I have some friends there, they were all like, fuck me, like, we just screw up the brand, like, people updating the LinkedIn profile, right, getting ready, and like it's like doomsday, yeah? And then, on the next day, a tweet comes and the conversation shifts. You know, it's always like that. And then on the following day, someone was dragged from a United Airlines plane. I don't know if you remember that, you know? But we need to force our memories now to remember that, right? And then, like, and everyone in United was like, oh my God, we just screwed up our brand. We're all fucked. Update LinkedIn profile. Well, the Pepsi guys were celebrating, like, because like the conversation had completely shifted. And then it shifts. And in that context, we did Google Home of the Whopper, which was like, we aired a TV spot that this spot would say, okay, Google, what's the Whopper sandwich? And then the Google Home would answer in the house of the people, right? I mean, that was very innovative back then. This is like 2 years ago. And it was like the first use of breaking the fourth wall type of use of the technology. And we got more than one way because we did Google block us, and then we find our way to unblock. We just changed the voice of the actor, and we did all that in like 2-3 hours. It was really fun to work on that project. It was one of the most talked about projects that we ever done for Burger King. It had 11 billion impressions. It won the Grand Prix in Cannes in direct response, because it was a direct response in an AI, right, or in a device, which was very innovative at that stage. And then we were at Burger King celebrating because we got more than one peak of talkability, because Google blocked us and we unblock, and then there was another discussion about privacy. We were there celebrating that people are only going to talk about us for the rest of their lives. It shifts again. It's always like that. So, like, my point to you is, like, usually the worst that can happen is nothing. But nothing tends to be a very common outcome of most marketing campaigns, especially the generic ones. So you may as well try to do something different to break that pattern and to stand above the noise, you know, like above that noise line, which for us is 2 billion with B impressions. Like, so when something doesn't work well for Burger King, we look at each other saying, oh, we only got 400 million impressions. And like, yeah, fuck it, you know, like, we'll do better next time. Yeah, I thought it would be better. Yeah, just 400 million, like 500 million impressions, you know, we need to do better. So we are so jaded that sometimes a company has 1 billion impressions, and we're like, yeah, like billions, like, but we did Impossible Whopper. Impossible Whopper had, how many, like six, I think it was around 6 billion. Andy Warhol on the Super Bowl was more than 7. The tour was 3.5. So we are used to like between 3 and 10 billion. For the good ones. So when it's less than 1 billion, oh yeah. But the thing is, even if it's 0.5 billion, which makes us sad, not sad, just disappointed, it's infinite times more on media than what we invested on the idea. So even when it's terrible, it's great. And I know many brands that die for a 0.5 billion pressure campaign, but we're jaded because they're used to like pull like such big numbers. So honestly, the worst that can happen is nothing. So just go for it. You know, like be afraid, but do the stuff, because it's not going to hurt your brand. It's going to hurt more long term if you're doing generic things, because then I can tell you it's going to be noise in the system. So this is another example of something that was like risky. Like this was a print campaign. We call it car crashes. They're all real pictures. We didn't crash my car to like take the picture. But we have like 17,000 locations around the globe. People drive all the time, look at their phones, so it usually someone crashes in the restaurant. And then it's just like, you cannot read, but what's written there is like, leave it to us, Burger King delivers, and our delivery partner, in the case of the US, it was DoorDash, and it has the date and where the location of the picture, you know? But like, can you imagine the stopping power of this as a print ad or as an out of home? People love watching a car crash. Sometimes you're driving, and there is traffic jams on both sides, and the car crashes on the other side, and everyone is like, looking, right? But people don't care about print ads, they don't look. So you need to make something that's relevant for people to pay attention to. Don't ask how the hell that happened. I really don't know like, how the guy entered entirely in the store. But this is how it looks in real life, you know? And then I don't have to do a media plan with 1,000 billboards. I do much less so, because I know it's going to cut through. And by the way, we were talking about this yesterday. Many times a print ad that we do for Burger King becomes digital because people take pictures and post and share. You know, so the reach today of an asset like this is much greater than if you do an asset that's more plain vanilla. Cool. So the last one, because I'm out of time, is One Team. And One Team has two aspects of One Team. One aspect of One Team is you with your agency partners, you know, and treat them as partners. You know, don't treat them as you are the client. The client is always right. Usually we are not. You know, like treat them as a partnership. You need them because there are lots of people in your company that will not get it. And you guys need to fight that fight together. I fight a lot with my partner agencies, but we do that behind closed doors. Or at least we try to do behind closed doors. And if we have an argument, we try to like have the argument by ourselves. Like to the world out there, we are like super close because we are super close. We are just very passionate about the work we do. And it's natural that if you're passionate and you are creative, you have arguments. That's so good. And then the second part of One Team is One Team within your organization. You know, my legal team is, they don't report to me, but they're part of my team. You know what I mean? The counties are part of my team. In the past, when I was at Unilever, I used to not see so clearly that way. It was much more siloed. You know, I was global, it was regional, then local. It's bullshit. For the consumer, none of that matters. You know, what it matters is that if everyone does a campaign together and an idea that everyone believes in and everyone pushes, it's going to have a much greater impact than if just one country does it. And with legal, for instance, I bring that on in the beginning of the project. They become part of the team and they brainstorm with us solutions so that we overcome the risks and the potential liabilities that we will have. If I only go to them in the end of the process, as a gatekeeper, if I were illegal, I would not approve anything. Because if I do, it's a success, we have a great marketing team. And if I do and we get litigated, we legal approved it, right? So what's the upside for legal? So they need to be part of the team. I'm using legal just as an example. Depending on which brand you are, it might be R&D, it might be operations, it might be supply chain, but make it One Team internal with your organization too. So just to wrap it up, this was the curve I showed in the beginning, right? This is the past 4 years, what happened. So we won 94 lines in 4 years. I think it was four GPs, two for Mac Whopper, one for Google Home, one for Bunny Stores. This is sales for the skepticals. Fast food is not a country that's exploding in growth, if you don't realize. Yeah? But in the past 4 years, we were double-digit sales 2 years, and we were high single-digit 2 years. I cannot talk about quarter one of 19 because it's not public information yet, but that's pretty damn good in terms of sales results for fast food. This is the value of the brand. It's public information. And red is Burger King. So you can see there the curve changing in angle in terms of the value of the brand. And I'm not, by the way, guys, it's not just because of marketing. You know what I mean? We improve profitability of the franchisees. We are building better restaurants. We have better franchisee partners. We are opening more restaurants. There are lots of things. But marketing surely helped push that growth in terms of the brand and in terms of sales. So just to wrap it up, and I did speak a lot, and I apologize for that. These are the five things that helped us change a bit the trajectory of the brand. You know, really understand your brand, the values and personality of the brand, create a great brief, try to do the exercise of writing like a one-line brief. Do that together with your agents, they will be able to help you. Let the idea grow, which has to do with trust and uncertainty, and having like and not killing an idea before nurturing it. You know, remember that the best ideas are not easy to do. Biggest risk is not taking any risk. And that one, remember that. I'm honest with you, like I'm afraid all the time. If I'm not afraid, I'll probably not do the idea. And that the worst that can happen is nothing. Yeah. Remember that the media cycles are short and frequent. And finally, one team, being one team with your partner agency and being one team within your own company. Like, I was lucky enough to be able to judge the award show that is going to be presented this Friday, and I saw like lots of great things there. And I know that Philippines has a history of doing great stuff. You know, like I still remember when I saw the plastic whale. I don't know how you call the campaign, it's plastic whale. Like, and so many other great things that came from here. I hope that you can leverage this presentation, especially the clients in the room, and push to do even more. You know, like I want to see more brands doing that type of work. You know, like brands being as great as some NGOs or PSAs in the country. Because I know that if you are going to bring a better business result. I would not survive at 3G Capital by winning Cannes Lions. You know, like winning Cannes Lions to me is important because I know it's important for the agency. And by winning Cannes Lions, we'll have more ideas being thrown at us, which I will convert in a stronger business and in stronger attributes for my brand. That's the game we are playing at Burger King. And it's a game that if you play it well, you will differentiate yourself in your market and you will help the business or the company where you're working grow faster than average. So that's my last few words for you guys. Hope you enjoyed the presentation. I surely enjoyed being here with you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Machado. Please be on stage. Now, we're privileged to have two agency leaders as